Hello, dear students. I'm Dr. Mazhar Ali, and I welcome you back to course Introduction to Computer Applications. Today, I'm going to discuss the basics of information system with you. The information system is a very significant part of information technology. Since the information technology is the emergence of a combination of computer science and communication systems. So if we think about the technology can be thought of as the application of scientific knowledge for practical purpose. And it started from the invention of the wheel to the harness of electricity for artificial things and other artificial intelligence inventions. So the technology is a part of our lives in so many ways that we tend to take it for granted. And the information technology brought a revolution in changing the world, in converting the world into globe. So now the whole world, all the organizations are connected with each other. And so when we are connected through the internet, we are the global, not the local. But when we are not connected through internet, then we are local. Otherwise, we are the global, because we may play a part globally through the different social media websites and internet resources. So internet, the information technology made us the global, and the information system is one of the important part of the information technology that is that performs a very significant role in this modern era, the era of information technology. Therefore, an information system is a formal sociological organizational system designed to collect the information, process the information, store the information, and distribute the information. And a computer information system is a system composed of people and computers that processes or interprets information. And it uses data stored in a computer databases to provide needed information. Therefore, a database is an organized collection of interrelated data reflecting a major aspect of a firm's activities. We discuss the database from different dimensions in our previous lecture that is available in this list. So the information system captures data from the organization, means the information system captures the internal data of an organization, as well as it captures the external data of organization. So the external data of an organization definitely comes through the external environment of the organization. Each organization has two environments. One is the internal environment, and second is the external environment. So information system takes data from both environment, means from internal environment, that is called the internal data, and from the external environment, that is called the external data. Since the business firms and other organizations rely on the information system to carry out and manage their operations, even the interact with their customers and suppliers and compete in a marketplace, because this is a modern era and there is a competition in the market is or the marketplaces. So information systems are used to run inter-organizational supply chains and electronic electronic markets. For instance, corporations use information systems to process financial accounts, to manage their human resources, and to reach their potential customers with the online promotions. Even nowadays, the online business organizations or online businesses are using the information systems to sell their products, to manage their products, to manage their accounts, to manage their employees, and so on. So the purpose of an information system is to turn raw data into useful information that can be used for decision making in an organization. Many information systems are designed to support particular processes within an organization or to carry out very specific analysis, because If you remember, we discussed earlier in previous lectures, data is basically raw facts that does not give you the complete understanding or complete meaning. However, after some specific processes, it comes into, or it converts into the information. Therefore, information system converts the data that is inputted to information system into information and provides to concerned authorities or persons or organizations or businesses. So customers are constantly taking about the products and services. If we talk about the online business organization who are using the information systems, and definitely there are several customers or various types of the customers are related to those business organizations or online shopping or websites or organizations, and they purchase their products. Therefore, the customers are there, clients who purchase their different products. So customers are important for any organization, and customers are constantly talking about the products and services that they use through different social media channels. And they are not shy in letting friends know through Facebook or Twitter or other social media if services was slow or means services of the online business or any organization are slow. So they tell the friends and their relatives through different social media websites. So while organizations have access to all of these reviews, blogs, and tweets, they often do not discern patterns and trends to make insightful decisions. Not only is all this disparate content hard to analyze, but the immense volume of data can be overwhelming, making it impossible to decipher what is relevant and what the motivation behind each post actually is. So as such, organizations are missing out on official data around exactly what customers thinking of their brand, product, or services. So these all things are provided by the information systems, because information system, as I told you earlier, that it collects the data from in different ways and stores that data and organizes in form of information to provide information to the managers, authorities, CEOs, and as well as to clients and other related persons. So it is the value from data, that what type of the data is inputted in the information system by the office systems or office officials or the external persons. So that all data is definitely measures, or the value of that data is retrieves. So the main purpose of the information system, if we see, it identifies the crucial business challenges, that what type of the challenges is facing by the business. So a business may know that what is the behavior of the clients, as I told you already, that clients focus the product and their services, and they tell their friends and families through different social medias. Therefore, this all data provides a platform to the management to identify that challenges and identify the drawbacks or the bad services of their business, as well as information system discovers consumer shopping habits as well, that what type of the products consumer likes to purchase or shop, and even it provides the personalized marketing as well. So there are different benefits, several benefits of the information systems for any organization, that may any business organization that provide viewing the or using the information system, customers and officials may be facilitated. And you may even monitor the health conditions through your data from wearables, means by using the information systems. And if the information system is used for any hospital, you may know the health condition of any patient of you. And if you are using for any other business purposes, you may know the you may analyze the product their sale, not sale, and other things. So it provides you complete live road mapping that one can analyze their businesses. And computers are useful because they simplify tasks that either take a long time for humans to do or are impossible for humans to do. Therefore, computers' reason for existence is vital, because a computer made the things proper, made the organization proper, and facilitate different business organizations in selling different products or running the organization proper way. Therefore, the importance of computers lies in the ability to simplify human tasks and perform tasks too complicated for humans. So computer does not only help you in selling or managing the products, but it help you in solving the different logical and mathematical problems, different textual problems, linguistic problems, and several other problems. And nowadays, the artificial intelligence, the part of the computer, changed the world or provided the world with different tools. The computer age introduced a new element to business, universities, and multitude of other organizations. So a set of components called the information system, which deals with collecting and organizing data and information. So an information system is a combination of hardware and software and telecommunication networks that people built to collect, create, and distribute useful data, typically in an organization. So it defines the flow means the flow of the information within the system. The objectives of an information system is to provide appropriate information to the user to gather the data or to processing of the data and communicate information to the users of the system. Therefore, an information system is described as having five major components that describes the information in a proper way. So the physical means of the storing information that is also important means the hardware or the computer software, and databases and data warehousing, telecommunications, and the human resources and procedures. These are very significant elements of information systems. So if we talk about the computer hardware is the physical technology that works with information. Means the hardware can be as a smartphone that fits in a pocket, or as a large as a supercomputer that fills a building. So hardware also includes the peripherals devices that work with the computers, such as a keyboard or the other internal and external disk drives and routers. With the rise of Internet of Things, commonly called the IoT, in which anything from home appliance to cars to clothes will be able to receive and transmit data, sensors that interact with the computers are the permitting the human environment. Therefore, information systems hardware is the part of an information system. You can touch the physical components of the technology, and the hardware for maybe the storage, process, communication systems, or networks, or different types of hardware which is used for the information systems. So therefore, when we process the data, when we input the data, when process the data and gets the output, and even when we transmit the data from one place to another place, definitely we need some physical means or the hardware or the computer hardware. And hardware, no doubt, hardware is a physical part of the information, physical part, which is required for the information system. But the hardware needs to know what to do, because hardware is just a physical part which cannot move, which cannot perform any activity if it is not given any order, like our body. So it is a hardware, and our body moves it per instructions which are given from the mind, which the brain. So brain runs till there is a soul in inside the body. So when soul exists from our body is a useless, just as a hardware. So soul is a basically software, and software is a set of instructions that tells the hardware what to do. So software is not tangible. It cannot be touched when programmers create software programs. What they are really doing is simply typing out lists of instructions that tell the hardware what to do. And definitely that is the role of the software. So there are several categories of software, with the two main categories being operating system and application software, which makes the hardware usable, and application software which does something useful. So information systems uses software to run the various processes, store the data in a database and get the data, collect the data, process the data, organize the data. These all things are managed through the different types of the softwares and definitely the major category of the software is the database and data warehouses. So it is the third component, is the database, that is a very much important for an information system. For example, your name, your father's name, your identity number, your street address, the city you live in, and your phone number are all a piece of data which are stored in any database systems. So the data is basically, because we store the data into database, we input the data into database, that is a very significant part of the information system. So the data is basically aggregated and indexed and organized together into a database, and data can become a powerful tool for any business, because when we input the data into any database, that is converted into information, that is converted into a record, and a record is a complete information of any product or any organization or any person. So organizations organized together into a database. Therefore, data can become a powerful tool for any business organizations. And that's why organizations collect all kinds of data and use it to make decisions. And these decisions can then be analyzed as to their effectiveness, and the organization even can be improved by analyzing the different data that is available in the databases or in information systems. So a database is a place where data is collected and from which it can be retrieved by querying it using one or more specific criteria. And a data warehouse contains all of the data in whatever form that an organization needs. So databases and data warehouses have assumed even greater importance in information systems with the emergence of big data, a term for the truly massive amounts of data that can be collected and analyzed. So these all things are very important, that may the physical part, may the storage or the procedures, how data will be processes or running, or the, you may call it the software, and the rules regarding the data use and distribute, how data will be stored and how it will be distributed among different partners or different environments, even the different organizations. And what will be the means? It means the communication system or network system, how the data will be distributed, either are you using the intranet or extranet, or these type of the communication system, and which tools be used to organize. Definitely, if you are using the database, so what type of the database application or tool will you use? So it depends on the organization, that what type of either SQL, MySQL, and several Oracle and several other tools are here to use to organize the data. So therefore, to distribute the data, as I told you, the communication system or the networks are required. And the communication system is a component connects the hardware to the pharma networks. It means different type of the networks. So connections can be through wires such as the Ethernet cables or fiber optics. It means it is called the connection that may be through the guided media and or the non-unguided media, that may be the wireless like the Wi-Fi and other types of the Wi-Fi. So a network can be designed to tie together computers in a specific area, such as an office or a school, through a local area network, commonly called the LAN. LAN means the LAN stands for a local area network. So besides the components of hardware, software and the data, which have long been considered the core technology of information systems, it has been suggested that one other component should be added. That is communication, means the means of distribution, how the data will be distributed. So communication, and it is a communication is such a core feature of today's information system that it has become its a category, means if any organization using the information system, it has to use a proper communication system, because it is the heart core of today's information systems. And who will run the information systems? Who will organize these all things which we discuss? Definitely human resources. Without human, there is a problems. And what type of the procedures will be used? So these are very important component of information systems. That is the human element. And the people that are needed to run the system and the procedures, they follow, so that the knowledge in the huge database and data warehouses can be turned into learning that can interpret what has happened in the past and guide future actions. Because decisions are made on basis of the data or the information that is available in the information systems. So any organization takes decisions on basis of available data. So when thinking about information systems, it is easy to get focused on the technology components and forget that we must look beyond these tools to fully understand how they integrate into an organization. So a focus on the people involved in information systems is the next step, definitely. So from the frontline help desk workers to system analysis to programmers, all the way up the chief information system, even the people involved with the information systems are an essential element that must not be overlooked. Because without people, without the managers, without the staff, without the office assistants, the data cannot be processed properly, or the information system cannot run properly. Therefore, it is associated with the manpower. Means the information system is associated with the manpower, which is required to run and manage the systems. So people are the end users of the information system, and end user use information produced for their own purpose. The main purpose of the information system is to benefit the end user, means who is the user of the information system. And the end user can be definitely accountant, engineer, salesperson, even the customer, clerk, or manager as well, and so others as well. So people are also responsible to develop and operate information systems. They include systems analysis, computer operators, programmers, and other clerical information system personnel, and manager technologies. Therefore, the human cannot be ignored. In this technological era, human cannot be ignored. So that is a myth that a human will be extra person. No, humans are very essential and fundamental asset for any information technology organization and the information systems. Office automation, if we talk about the office automation, so office automation systems are computer-based information systems that collect, process, store, and transmit the electronic messages. So we may call the documents and other forms of communications among the individuals, work groups, and organizations. The office automation system manage and organize these messages, documents, and other form of communications. So a variety of office automation systems are now applied to business and communication functions that used to be performed manually or in multiple locations of a company, such as preparing written communications and strategic planning. Therefore, automation systems performs their role automatically to run the information systems. So they perform various office tasks. As I told you, receive the message, analyze the message, or provide the messages to concerned persons, and allows users to efficiently handle data, what type of the data is inputted or inserted into the information system. And even the tedious tasks become simple. What are the silo or other some tasks? The automation system make them the simple. So these are also important for any organization. So now it depends on organization that what type of the automation systems are they using. Even they may use the office or other, even so in the information system provide you the automation system through different tools and techniques to be connected with the customers or clients. For example, you are shopping from the Daraz, you will be dealt automatically through the different automation systems. Or if you are shopping from Daraz, Alibaba, or eBay, or Amazon, Google, and so on, several information systems are here. So the automation systems manage these all things. The transaction processing system is also an important type of the information system. A transaction processing system, commonly called the TPS, is a set of information that processes the data transition in database systems that monitors transaction programs. So the system is useful when something is solved over the internet. And it allows for time delays between when an item is being solved to when it is actually solved. So transaction processing systems consists of computer hardware and software hosting a transaction orientation applications that perform the online transactions necessary to conduct businesses. Examples include a system that manage sales order entry, airline reservation, payroll or the employees' records, manufacturing, and shipping, and so on. Therefore, transaction is a complete event that may be performed for air ticket, railway ticket reservation, or other reservations, or other jobs, payrolls, or to check or enter the office employee record, and so on. There are many different types of transaction processing systems, or TPSs, as I told you. Payroll, inventory control, order entry, accounts payable, accounts receivable, and others. So, there are two ways to process transactions. One is using the batches, and the second is real time. So, in a batch processing system, transactions are accumulated over a period of time and processed as a single unit or a batch. For example, a store may update its sales records every day after the store closes. So there may be hundreds of records, thousands of records, but all the records will be processed in a single batch, in single file, or will maybe processed. Or a payroll system, even if we take the example of payroll, so payroll system may process all the time cards every 2 weeks to determine employees' things and produce paychecks. So whatever the time period in a batch system, there is some time delay between the actual event and the processing of the transaction to update the records of an organization. So in a real-time processing system, transactions are processed immediately as they occur without any delay to accumulate transactions. So real-time processing is also referred to as online transaction processing, or OLTP. So OLTP means online transaction processes. So in this case, the records and system always reflect the current status. If you look, if when you are shopping online, you perform the real-time transaction or online transaction. Even when you have go to bank ATM and perform any transaction, that is an online transaction, a real-time transaction, and that is updated at the same time. For example, you are transferring the fund from your account to another account, that will be transferred virtually. Means that is a real-time transaction, and online it is updated in your bank record or bank account online. So this is the real-time transaction processes. Since the batch processing is not the online that performed at the end of time. For example, bank performed their all file at the closing time, or any shop perform their transaction at the closing of shop. So, and you may even track and process the transaction. For example, you have sent any shop, you have a shop any product from online or business shop. So you may track the transaction that where your product is reached, you know, or if you send the your any post through any courier service, they provide you tracking number and you may track that where is my post now, and if it is received by the concerned person, the message will be shown to you that it is received and signed by this person. So the transaction processing system provide you facility of tracking as well. And each step in the transaction process is monitored. Even the you are sending fund, transferring fund to other account, or you are sending any product or receiving any product or doing any transaction, all the steps will be monitored. And if error occurs, that is also told to you, even in your address or in any transaction process, that will be remedied immediately, and if not remedied, then it will be told to you. So another type of the information system, and nowadays it is commonly used, that is the MIS, Management Information System. So a management information system, commonly called the MIS, is a computer system consisting of hardware and software that serves as the backbone of an organization's operations. So an MIS gathers data from multiple online systems, analyzes the information, and reports data to aid in management decision making. MIS is an effective tool for decision making. Therefore, Management Information System, or MIS, has played an important role in the organization from the last two decades by providing the information generating tool. MIS provides regular information to managers to allow them to make decisions based on data rather than guesses. The first step in the making sense of the information collected is arranging it correctly. And accuracy and grouping of data determines the quality of the analysis. Therefore, the person responsible for this often tedious and seemingly unending task should be a patient and definitely meticulous. So once you have established why you want the information, you set about collecting it. The collection could take various forms, such as a conversation and a discussion group, a questionnaire or a survey or a telephone call, an online form, and etc. So analyzing the information talks to the skills and ability to take data and turn it into a reliable and a meaningful story. Therefore, this is a highly sought skill, and companies are willing to pay handsome amount for this ability. So MIS basically organizes and evaluates all the information that that is provided. Therefore, it is an important and significant tool for any organizations to provide concrete data for taking decisions. And it summarizes the report based on the need, means it filters what type of the report is required to organization. Either employees, either product, and if product, then what dimension you required, either sale, either storage, stock, loss, profit, and so on. So definitely managers of any organization required different views of data to analyze it. This is not only good for the organization who run their business or shopping, any shop, but all the other organizations as well, you know, like the universities, like the other organization, and so on. So a summary report is a report or a short written communication that may have a variety of purposes that is also generated by MIS. So MIS is a very important tool of the computer systems, and it is a significant type of the information system that is commonly used by different organizations. And DSS, the decision support system, it is a computerized program used to support determinations, judgments, and courses of action in organizations or business. So DSS or decision support systems, mostly the computer person call it the DSS, but the business persons call it the decision support systems, and some call it the DSS. So DSS shifts through and analyzes massive amounts of data, compiling comprehensive information that can be used to solve problems and in the decision making. For example, one of the DSS applications is the management and the development of a complex anti-terrorism systems. And other examples include a bank loan, bank loan officer verifying the credit of a loan application, or an engineering firm that has bid on several projects and wants to know if they can be competitive with their costs. So because you take the decision, so decision support system help you in taking the decision, because it analyze, check and analyze the data of the any person, contractor, organization, and that is provided to you in form of a report that either it is a good or bad, or either this organization or person differs something or no one, or this is a faulty or not faulty, and so on. So DSS support you in taking the decision. Therefore, DSSs or decision support systems are interactive software-based systems intended to help managers in decision making by accessing large volumes of information generated from various related information systems involved in organizational business processes, such as office automation systems, transaction processes, systems, and etc. So different data and the criteria are evaluated for different purposes. As I told you, the example of the loan, for example, a bank is again giving loan to any person. So the data and criteria will be evaluated by this decision support system. That from, is the, that person or that organization took a loan from other banks, and is there sufficient income status of that person or organization that he or she, it may be granted with a loan. So these all things are provided by the decision support system. Even if you are not using any proper information system, you may make decision support system through different spreadsheets, MS Excel and so on. So these all things provide you data and reports. And those reports are the basically tailored and structured properly. So different tools are here that support you in taking the decisions. Another type of the information system, and that is the very latest and especially using by the artificial intelligence, that is called the expert system. So Meissen, and there are several types of the expert systems. Expert system performs tasks done by a person and analyze data and suggest an action accordingly. So an expert system is the highest form of automation of the management computing office, which allows documents, communication, and manipulation. So decision support systems help with the problem solving by allowing data and model manipulation. So expert system go beyond conventional manipulation of this kind, and they allow experts to teach computers about their fields so that fewer expert decision makers can even support the systems more of the decision making processes. Therefore, expert systems are one of the most cutting edge information technology fields. That is in some of the most complex and least understood human information handling task. That is the decision making problem, solving diagnosis and learning. So they help people in a different ways through providing. So expert system, as I told you, these are the computer systems. So they help people in different ways in solution of different problems. We do this by holding a large amount of factual information on a subject area, along with the lines of reasoning employed in that field by human experts. So, as I told you, that nowadays the expert systems are used by developed through the different artificial intelligence tools or agents or the algorithms. So, in artificial intelligence, an expert system is a computer system that emulates the decision-making ability of a human expert. So expert systems are designed to solve complex problems by reasoning through bodies of knowledge represented mainly as if-then rules. The most common expert systems are working on rules, if and then. If this happens, then this will be the result. So rather than through the conventional procedure of code. So if we talk about the different parts of expert systems, including the inference engines, there are different parts of the expert system. For example, the user interface, that is a very important and significant part of the expert system, because if user will not interface to expert system, then how expert system will be useful, or how expert system will process. Therefore, the user interface contains a computerized system between the user and the machine for friendly communication. So this system provides an interface to the user in a graphical way. So if you hear a very common expert system, Meissen provide you a solution of different medical problems. If you ask the Meissen will diagnose you and provide you different medicines. And the other part of the expert system is in interference engine. Inference engines. So inference engine analyze the data and makes the decision. Even it regains and determines the data processes that what type of the data is entered, and it performs this task to deduce the new facts which are subsequently used to draw further conclusions. So the component is associated with an expert system is the brain of the expert system, because all the conclusions are drawn on basis of inference engines. What type of the conclusion you want to draw, the expert system will concerned with the what inference engine. Another very important part of expert system is a knowledge base. This is the most important element of the expert systems because it holds the expert's knowledge of problem solving, and it is here that the expert's elicited knowledge is stored, and it contains the rules, facts, and object descriptions, etc. So the knowledge base is always stored in the data with the newest expert system products. The knowledge base information is all that is needed to understand and formulate the problem and then solve it. Therefore, all the means the knowledge is influenced by the engines. So when we draw the conclusion, when we take any result, definitely the knowledge base performs their important role. And another, the data acquisition subsystems. So the specialist is to learn the information reflected in the knowledge base. So information acquisition software is used by a person who has problem experience to build, incorporate, or modify the base of knowledge. So the potential knowledge sources include human experts, research reports, textbooks, databases, and the other experiences of themselves. These are very significant parts of the expert system that make the expert system powerful and significant, and enable expert system to solve the human problems or real world problems. Nowadays, expert systems are built or developed for engineering purposes, for medical purposes, for social problems, psychological problems, even the computer learning problems. Different things are problems. Therefore, expert system is one of the significant type of the information system. So this is a view of the expert system. If you see, this is the subject expert, and these are the databases where important data is kept or stored, and these are the customer or common people or any organization, and so on. And you see, these all things are connected with the knowledge base, means these all things are there is an inference engine. Here is inference engines that is connected with the knowledge base and others. And there are facts, a database. Here are the rules and facts that how this knowledge is used. Knowledge base is used. So there are facts and rules which are definitely defined, and so on. Another thing that is the technology. Definitely, without technology, information systems cannot run properly. So that is means if you are running your standalone computer. Standalone is a computer that is not connected with any type of the networking or internet. That is a standalone. Means what type of the softwares are installed in your system, you may use that. You may not be connected with others. So in that that situation is called you are in a standalone environment. So a standalone environment does not need any intranet or extranet. So intranets is a definitely networking type of the networking, and it is using local area network or other networks that facilitate the internal structure of the organization. This is called also the private network, and it uses the internet. Why it is a private network? Because the employees of any specific organization use this networking or the intranet. No extra person can use the intranet. So it provides security to the organization. Means other people cannot enter the organization or the in the processes of organization. So employees use intranet to access different data that is available in information system of in the organization for organization's priority purposes. And the database are stored on this intranet that hackers or intruders or other people cannot disturb the organization or enter in the servers. Therefore, all the databases are on intranet. And access to outside user is blocked, as I told you. No outsider or external person can access to those servers or databases. So this is for a specific people who are working in the organization. It means all the employees of organization. For this purpose, login detail is provided to every employee. Means their login ID and the password. And definitely the servers and the computers, workstations are connected some private IPs or some special IPs that no other can access that. So this is also very important that your important data cannot be accessed by the external person. So this technology is very much necessary for the information system. And the extranet is also type of the networking, and it also uses the internet. So as I told you, in the intranet, only the employees of the organization can use the intranet, can access the data that is available in the servers. However, extranet provides facilitate the external persons that may be the contractors, that may be the suppliers, that may be the business partners in different way, because one business takes resources from other business. This is called the business to business process. So definitely, if you are running any business, you are running the business of food, you are running business of cloth, stitching, or other things, definitely you need the supporting material from other businesses. So that is called, as I told you, business to business process, and that that communication needs the extranet. So extranet is the extra network which we are using here. External person may access your organization, but with a specific permission. They may not use the organization's assets as the employees are using. They may use, for example, they may view the tenders, they may email, they may email for the product rates and so on, and they may know their financial position or bills and so on. Means some specific things they may see, or for some specific purpose they may contact the organization. So goal is basically to simplify a process and to keep the organization secure from the externals. So like the manufacturer keeps little material in their stock, so that stock may be shown to other businesses and so on. So the extranet is for external persons, and the intranet for internal persons. This is the purpose of intranet and extranet. Another type of the networking that is also significant for the information systems, so that is called the virtual private network. So mostly the VPN, a very common term, VPN. So a VPN, or virtual private network, is an encrypted connection over the internet from a device to a network. So the encrypted connection helps ensure the sensitive data is safely transmitted. Means what type of the data you are transferring or transmitting from one device to another device, that ensures, VPN ensures that it is a safe. It's a transforming is a safe. So it prevents unauthorized people from eavesdropping on the traffic, and allows the user to conduct work remotely. And it uses tunneling protocols to encrypt data at the sending end and decrypt it at the receiving end. We discussed in the previous lectures. And Tunneling, if we talk about the tunneling procedure, so tunneling is a basically protocol, and it is a communication protocol that allows the movement of data from one network to another network. And it involves allowing private network communication to be sent across a public network, such as the internet, through a process called encapsulation. Encapsulation is also packet that make your data secure. So tunneling is a technique that enables remote access users to connect to a variety of network resources like the corporate to home gateways or an internet service providers or ISPs through a public data network. In general, tunnels established through the public network are point to point. Through a multiple tunnel is possible even sometimes, and link a remote user to some resources at the far end of the tunnel. So major tunneling protocols, that is a layer two tunneling protocols, A2TP, commonly call it, or the point-to-point tunneling protocol, PPTP, and layer two forwarding L2F, even the. So these encapsulate layer two traffic. So from the remote user and send it across the public network to the far end of the tunnel. So where it is de-encapsulated and sent to its destination. So the most significant benefit of tunneling is that it allows for the creation of VPNs, or VPN means virtual private network, over public data networks to provide a cost saving for both end users who do not have to create dedicated networks and service providers who cannot leverage their network investments across many VPNs customers. So it's a very good way to protect the data during transmitting when you are working on the internet, for example, Daraz, Alibaba, eBay, and your other these business organizations who are working through the internet, they must use, but they are using the VPN for the safety of their data. Even employees used to work from home through if organizations have VPN, as we discussed previously, commuters. So people work from their homes or coffee shops or their other places to work for their organization because their processing and transmitting of data is safe. So and even the electron networks used to connect securely, because hackers cannot be entered in that network if the organization is using a VPN protocol, a VPN system. So once VPN is established, the VPN is transparent as well. Means all things are transparent. If you look here, this is a VPN tunnel. Here, data is encrypted, and definitely, all the encrypted data is packets are means encapsulation. When we put your data in a packet or in a capsule, so that is definitely safe and secure. No one can see that data. So through the tunnel, all the data is going in an encrypted packet. Means no one can know that what type of data is that. However, when this data is went and reached to the destination, that data will be decrypted, means will be shown to in the original form. Here, for example, you have sent ABC, and if a hacker reach this packet and open it, then the data will show it XYZ. Since you have sent as ABC, so hacker cannot reach your message. Reach your data. However, the person whom you sent this data can reach your message. So the VPN tunnel is a very secure way to reach the data, or sorry, to keep safe data. Another the electronic data interchange, commonly called the EDI. So electronic data interchange is a concept of business electronically communicating information that was traditionally communicated on paper originally, if you look, all the communication was done by paper, writing paper and sent through post office or any courier services. But now it is changed. So all data is sent through emails and other information systems or through the intranet and so on. So the traditional system has been converted into electronic system. And it's only because of the information technology. So, further, even we may send the purchase order, we may send the invoices, we may send other emails, we may send other things through the email and other electronic data interchange. So, technical standards for EDI exist to facilitate parties transacting such as instruments without having to make special arrangements. These all things are done by EDI. And so data transferred in a precise manner. For example, you are sending through a database or through email or through other messenger, WhatsApp, and so on, or even your information system, even in through your personal communication system or email system, or no one can access. So networks often share an information system. Information system, if you are using any information system and that is shared and online, you may even, your data will be shared as well. So over time, definitely, this saves the money of organization, means which money was investing on the post office and courier services and other resources, that money is saved because of the electronic data interchange. So definitely, this is a great development by the information technology that converted the world into e-transaction system or emails or electronic data transferring and so on. Another very important thing for the information system, because if your organization is big, then definitely there is a huge data. So for huge data, you need the data warehousing. So a data warehousing is the process of constructing and using a data warehouse. A data warehouse is constructed by integrating data from multiple heterogeneous sources that support analytical reporting, structured and or ad hoc queries and decision making. In computing, a data warehousing, also known as an enterprise data warehouse, is a system used for reporting and data analysis and is considered a core component of a business intelligence. So data warehousing are central repositories of integrated data from one or more disparate sources. Or even we may say a data warehouse works as a central repository where information arrives from one or more data sources. So data flows into a data warehouse from the transactional system and other relational databases. Definitely it works 24/7. That means users is provided access to data, a data warehouse 24/7. So definitely there is a time variant. So in this data, means in the time variant, if we talk about our time variant, in this data is maintained via different intervals of time, such as a weekly, monthly, or annually, etc., because warehouse maintain it. And it founds various time limits, which is structured between the large data sets, and it is held in the online transaction process or online OLTP. Another facility of the data warehouse is a fault tolerant. A fault tolerance or fault tolerant refer to ability of a system. When we talk about system, means a computer system, even the definitely when we talk about the data warehouse, if you look here, it is a network through different systems. So system means a computer system, network system, and nowadays cloud clustering and so on. So data warehouse refer to a system to continue operating without interruption when one or more if its components fail. So this is the definitely fault tolerance. When any component fails, data warehouse works. Data warehouse does not show inability or not working to the clients. So fault-tolerant systems use backup components that automatically take the place of failed components, ensuring no loss of service. For example, this one part of data warehouse going to be failed. The backup of that part, that storage place, will automatically work, and that is called the fault tolerance. When the user or client does not feel, means the user or client may be facilitated with the same resources, it is the fault tolerance facility of that component. And here we discuss about data warehouse. Means data warehouse is a basically fault tolerant house. So fault tolerance on a system is a feature that enables a system to continue with its operations even when there is a failure on one part of the system. So system can continue its operations at a reduced level rather than be failing completely. So this helps in fault isolation through failure detection mechanism. And another feature of the data warehouse is the data security that provides security to clients and keep their data secure. So data warehouse security is defined as the mechanism which ensures the confidentiality, integrity, and availability of the data warehouse and its components which are attached with the data warehouse. So data warehousing process its own set of challenges for security. For example, the enterprise data warehousing are often very large systems serving many user communities with varying security needs, and while data warehouses require a flexible and a powerful security infrastructure, so the security capability must seamlessly operate in an environment which has stringent performance and scalability requires. So security must be built into the core of the data warehouse, and the data warehouse provide complete security because it is a built-in in the features, built-in as a feature of the data warehouse, or the data security is a built-in in the data warehouse. So it provides complete security to all the data that is connected or that is kept in the data warehouse. The enterprise storage, or we may call it the data storage, is a fundamental for any organization, from the smallest startups to the largest corporations. While a company might start off with one IT storage solution, it could quickly outgrow that system as it scales, forcing leadership to rethink how it manages and accesses data across the network, different networks. So now here is the issue, more important and complicated than when it comes to enterprise data storage. Because when an organization reaches the enterprise level, the data storage solutions that are in place may no longer be sufficient for higher volume workloads. So many enterprises operates in on premises data solution, but they may need to migrate some resources into a co-location facility to increase capacity or implement redundancy for disaster mitigation. However, the organization plans to grow, so it must consider how is it IT infrastructure will store and manage data throughout that process. So enterprise data storage must address a variety of user and customers' demands while also positioning itself to handle the data demands imposed by new technology. Therefore, internet storage is a centralized repository for business information that provides common data management, protection, and data sharing functions through connections to computer systems and other important aspects of an enterprise storage systems are unlimited connectivity and support for multiple platforms. And definitely there are different methods and technology to store how, what type of the method we will discuss in the coming slide, that what type of the method is used to store the data and what technologies are used, and definitely efficiently store large amounts of data. So these all things are very much important for any enterprise data storage, because in the enterprise data warehouse or the is a form of the corporate repository that stores and manages all the historical business data or of an enterprise. So enterprise storage hardware is where most of the data you don't use every day goes, we store. It depending on the type of the data you are storing there. So these are either solutions that focus on minimizing how long it takes to access the data, or even cheaper offline solutions that take you a while to access your information. So if we talk about the technologies, so there is a solid state drive storage, commonly called the SSD. The SSD contains no moving parts and so are pretty robust when comparing to magnetic methods like tape and disk. Instead, they rely on semiconductors and electronics for storing data, meaning they use less power than their alternative too. This type of the devices we discussed in a lecture on storage, computer storage devices. And even the clouds are the nowadays technology where the data may be stored properly. So enterprise cloud storage consists of a storage capacity purchased from a public cloud service provider. Enterprises often turn to cloud storage to reduce or eliminate excessive on-premises storage costs, even reduce the complexity of managing storage and upgrade data center infrastructure. So these are some sort of the technologies. Even the, for example, we may access the data through these technologies. Even the RAID and NAS are two important types of the data storage in enterprise storage. So RAID basically, RAID stands for redundant array of independent disk. Redundant array of independent disk or disks. So it is a method of enhancing disk performance, increasing storage capacity, and improving fault tolerance depending on the RAID level chosen. So RAID enables the same data to be saved across multiple disks while still appearing as a single logical drive using a specialized hardware or a software called a RAID controller. Another type is a NAS or NAS. So NAS basically is storage. This is a network storage area, and there is also SAN storage area network and so on. So NAS is basically network attached storage. It is often used in conjunction with the SAN storage area network systems as a way of accessing and managing the files contained within SAN, S-A-N, SAN blocks. So where SAN consists of the storage area, SAN means storage area network. So where SAN consists of several devices. So NAS are the network attached storage applies to a single storage device. So now servers tend to connect to the network through an ordinary Ethernet connection and use a dedicated operating system to manage the files through well-established protocols. So many organizations use network attached storage or NAS systems for storing files that multiple users need to access and need to be backup. So a NAS device can easily be configured to create a redundancy, backing up files quickly and locally to mirrored storage drives without having to transmit them elsewhere in the network or shift them to the cloud. So with the data management becoming more and more crucial to business success, if you are running the business, online business, the data management, no doubt, it is a crucial job. So it's important for enterprises to select a data storage solution that best meets their needs. While similar to medium-sized companies might be able to manage with the purely NAS or the network attached storage approach, or enterprise-level organizations generally need to incorporate SAN, storage area network storage solution, into their IT architecture to ensure superior speed and performance for the networks. So building a network that incorporates SAN and NAS, principals can provide them with the flexibility they need to meet the demands of big data and other technology innovations. So it depends on the organization that what type of the storage solution are they are going to use. Now that we are going to discuss the RAID in detail with by defining it, say, even the levels as well. So RAID is a data storage visualization technology that combines multiple physical disk drives components into one or more logical units for the purposes of data redundancy and performance improvement, definitely, or even the both. So RAID distance far, as I told you, redundant array of inexpensive disk, and it links a number of hard drives which are available in the cluster of RAID. So RAID is not a single hard disk, but there may be several hard disks and provide data redundancy and even can speed up the access to the data. So there are different levels of the data which we discuss in the coming slides. But however, RAID provides a data redundancy by storing the same data twice on multiple hard disks. So data redundancy means means that I talk about this. So it means that if one part of the system fails, for example, you are running any business and any hard disk is failed, what will happen? Definitely, but be relaxed. No data is lost because there's a data redundancy. So redundancy means that if one part of the system fails, no data will be lost. So in a typical RAID system, multiple disks are stacked on top of each other. A RAID system uses at least two hard disk drives, but can use many more, 16 and so on. So it depends on the organization, how many hard disks are using under the RAID. And RAID levels, which are denoted, if we talk about the levels, so these levels, which are denoted by a number determine the performance characteristics of a given configuration and how much of a little data protections they offer. Therefore, in a RAID, level zero, also called the data stripping, block level data is simply distributed but not copied across multiple drives and improving performance and storage capacity, but not offering enhanced protection. So we discussed these levels in detail in coming slide. This is a RAID level zero. So RAID level zero splits or you may call it stripes or spurious data, even the across two or more disks without parity information. Parity is a basically checking bit. It is a parity is a basically checking bit that check these the data. So without a parity information and a redundancy of fault tolerances are there in a RAID level 0. So since RAID 0 provides no fault tolerance or redundancy, the failure of one drive will cause the entire array to fail. For example, this drive fails. As a result of having data striped across all disks, the failure will result in total data loss. So this configuration is typically implemented having speed as the intended goal. So RAID 0 is normally used to increase performance, though it can also be used as a way to create a large logical volume out of two more physical disks. RAID 0 or RAID level 0 can be created with a disk of different sizes, but the storage space added to the array by each disk is limited to the size of the similar disk. So if you look at this diagram, the diagram shows how the data is distributed into AX stripes on two disks with the A1 to A2 as the first stripe. This is the first stripe, and or A3 to A4, the second stripe is the second one, etc. So once the stripe size is defined during the creation of a RAID 0 array, it needs to be maintained at all times. So since the stripes are accessed in parallel, an N drive array or an N drive RAID 0 array appears as a single large disk with a data rate in times higher than the single disk rate. This is a RAID level 1. If you look here, there are multiple RAID disks. And RAID 1. So if we talk about the RAID 1, RAID 1 is consisted of an exact copy. So this is RAID in RAID 1, what happens? It's mirroring, basically. It's mirroring. If you will see, 1, 2, 3, 4. There are four hard disks, and this is the mirror of this one. And this disk is a mirror of this one. Means this is the backup. This is the backup of this side, and this hard disk, and this is a backup of this hard disk. So it is called a mirror. So RAID 1 mirrored pair contains two disks. These two disks, if you look here, and these two disks, if you look here. So this configuration offers no parity. There's no need to check the parity. However, in RAID 0, there was a parity. So there's a offers no parity, even the striping or the spanning of a disk space across multiple disks. Since the data is mirrored on all disks belonging to the array, and the array can only be as big as the smallest member disk. So this layout is useful when read performance or reliability is more important than write performance or the resulting data storage capacity. And data are stored twice by writing them to both the data drive or set of data drives and a mirror drive or a set of drives. So if a drive fails, the controller uses either the, if for example this drive is a fails, for example, the controller uses either the data drive or the mirror drive. So controller definitely will use this drive, so user or the customer will not be affected. And then the RAID 3, RAID level 3. So RAID 3, which is rarely used in the practice, consists of a byte level stripping with a dedicated parity disk. So one of the characteristics of RAID 3 is that it generally cannot service multiple requests simultaneously, which happens because any single block of data will by definition be spread across all members of the state and will resides in the same physical location on each disk. So therefore any IO or input output operation requires activity on every disk and usually requires synchronized spindles, which run the disk. So this makes it suitable for applications that demand the highest transfer rates in long sequential reads and writes. For example, uncompressed video editing, applications that make small reads and writes from random disk locations will get the worst performance out of this level. So the requirement that all disk spin, all the requirements that all disk spin synchronously in a definitely look step added design considerations that provided no significant advantages over the RAID level. So both RAID 3 and 4 were quickly replaced by RAID 5. And RAID 3 was usually implemented in hardware, and the performance issue were addressed by the user using large disk caches. And RAID level 4 consists of blocks level stripping with the dedicated parity disk is a result of its layout. So RAID 4 provides good performance of random reads, while the performance of random writes is low due to the need to write of parity data to a single disk. So even if you look in the diagram here, a read request for block A1, if you look here, for example, a read request for block A1 would be served by disk 0, this one. So a simultaneous read request for block B1, for example, if we look at then the definitely block B would have to wait. But a read request for B2 could be served concurrently by disk 1. And RAID 5 basically consists of a block level stripping with the distributed parity. So unlike in the RAID 4, parity information is distributed among the drives. So it requires that all drives but one be present to operate. Upon failure of a single drive, means for example one drive is going to be failure, a subsequent read can be calculated from the distributed parity such that no data is lost. So that is a great benefit of this RAID 5. So RAID 5 requires at least 3 disks, means there should be minimum 3 disks. And RAID 5 is the most common security RAID level. It requires at least 3 drives, as I told you, minimum there should be the 3 drives. However, there may be the more drives. If this drive is going to be failed, then this drive will work, or other drives maybe work. So additionally, write performance is increased since all the RAID members participate in the serving of the write request. So although it will not be efficient as striping as RAID 0 means setup, because parity must still be written. So this is no longer a bottleneck like here. So diagram of RAID 5 setup with the this is the diagram of RAID 5 setup with the distributed parity, with each color representing the group of blocks. These are the group of the blocks. We discussed NAS already, network attached storage. So this is the storage system. So NAS, or the network attached storage, is a file level as opposed to the block level storage. This is the file level storage, means the computer data storage server connected to connected to a computer network providing data access to a heterogeneous group of clients. So NAS is specialized for serving files either by its hardware, software, or configuration. Means hardware or software configuration. So it is often manufactured as a computer appliance, a purpose-built specialized computer. So NAS are network attached storage systems are networked appliances that contains one or more storage drives, often arranged into a logical redundant storage containers or even the RAID, like the RAID. So network attached storage removes the responsibility of the serving from other servers on the network. And this is a very great facility of the NAS that it reduces the load of servers. They don't need to provide services regarding storage. NAS provides services to as a server as well in the form of storage. So network attached storage removes the responsibility of the serving from other servers on the network. The typically they typically provide access to files using network file sharing protocols such as NFS, SMB, or AFP. Since the storage area network is a secure high-speed data transfer network that provides access to consolidated block-level storage, NAS is not block level storage. NAS is a file level storage, since the storage area network is a high speed data transfer network, or the it is the block level storage. So a SAN, or the storage area network, makes a network of storage devices accessible to multiple servers. If you look here, this is the server and this is the network attached storage, or NAS. So NAS is attached definitely server, but it provides services in the file level. Since the storage area network is different than the NAS. So as I told you, a storage area network or a storage network is a computer network that provides access to consolidated block level data storage. SANs means storage area networks. So SANs are primarily used to access storage devices such as a disk arrays and a tape libraries from servers so that the devices appear to the operating system as a direct attached storage. And even the SAN storage area network is a secure high-speed data transfer network that provides access to consolidated block-level storage. So a SAN makes a network of storage devices accessible to multiple servers, and SAN devices appear to servers as attached drives. Means SANs are attached drives, since the network attached drives is not attached drives, it works externally. Therefore, a NAS is a single storage device that serves files over Ethernet and is relatively inexpensive and easy to set up, while a SAN is a tightly coupled network of multiple devices that work with the block-based data and is more expensive and complex to set up and manage. In information technology, a backup or a data backup is a copy of computer data taken and stored elsewhere so that it may be used to restore the original after a data loss. It means, for example, when data is going to be lost, the backup will be used in place of lost data. So backups can be used to recover data after its loss from data detection or corruption. Means if the data is going to be corrupted or lost, or to recover data from an earlier time. So backup, even in your mobile phone, you backup the data by restoring your mobile phone or by using the backup application. So backups provide a simple form of disaster recovery. However, not all backup systems are able to reconstitute computer systems or other complex configurations, such as a computer cluster, Active Directory server, or a database server. So a backup system contains at least one copy of all the data. There should be a one copy of all the data that can be restored at a time, because backup protects files and setting your system. As I told you, for example, you are using the smartphone and you have lost your settings or lost your basic files. You may restore all the settings and files and protect your data, and so you may store the data and restore the data and settings as well. So when you are working on information systems, and definitely information systems are big, so if they are the data is lost or settings are definitely lost, then you may restore the data and the settings through and different backups. Even the transaction rollback, you may do the transaction rollback through different applications of backups. So logs, log file, other things you may restore or recover. Even tape backups, so for example, if you are using the tape drives, you may copy files to a tape and may be used even when you want to restore. So even you may make backup on the CDs and DVDs and your other storage devices, and you may use those backups when you need or when you want to restore. So information system is an integral part of any organization. Nowadays, organizations are using the information system in different HR, in different forms, like the HR, like admission systems, like hiring systems, like other systems, teaching systems, LMS, and so on. So it is an integral part of any organization. And definitely, when you are using the information system, you have to maintain the equipments which are related to information systems, software and data as well. So it enables other, definitely, employees to function. Means what are the responsible, who are people are responsible, they have to perform, they have to maintain these systems. For information system, you need the trained employees who know the computer systems, who know the information system, who know the strategies and the development of the information systems. So there are different names for information systems, like the information system, the commonly and management information systems, and so on. So these are all are the part of information technology. So thank you very much for hearing me, and hope you understand the information system, different types of information system, how information system works, and what type of the technology is important, and what type of technological tools are required, which people should use and run the information systems, and what is the significance of information system in modern era. These all things are the basics of the information. We could not discuss the information system in the detail, however we discuss the basics of information system. And as you are the students of first semester, so for you these are for you these are only these basic parts of the information systems are, I think, be useful. So watch this lecture again and make the note and ask question in comment box. I will respond to you. I will reply your all questions. Take care.